All right, so we're going to talk about how to make your jQuery plugins modular. We're going to be talking about a whole slew of different things. We'll mention and look over the jQuery UI Widget Factory for making plugins. And that construction hat is actually an icon for a new library that I'll be, I guess, officially open sourcing today. It's very similar to the Widget Factory. It's new, and I'm terrible at making icons, so if any of you our designers, please tweet me or send me a message because I cannot make icons. We'll talk about Grunt, about making custom builds on the command line. And we'll also talk about another library that I built a while ago for making custom web UI, custom downloads. You see a lot of really cool jQuery plugins like Twitter Bootstrap. You can only, they give you a little custom build. They don't split up their individual plugins for custom build. But I'll show you how to do that, and maybe, just maybe, we can get them to do the same thing. So I gave myself a little presentation slide, even though Adam also presented me. Again, I'm Greg Franko. My day job is I'm a JavaScript engineer with AdThis. So what that means is I do a lot of third-party JavaScript, and I do a lot of JavaScript without jQuery for my day job. We host a lot of content on CDNs, and we worry about every single byte that is being used because people are linking to our CDN. So when our code base was originally written, we didn't include jQuery. With all the custom build options that jQuery is offering now, I think we probably would have reconsidered because we essentially built jQuery, just not as well. Let's see, open source stuff. I love open source, as I'm sure a lot of you do. There's a lot of passionate open source developers here. I'm a part of the Boilerplate MVC team. We're a new team. And we're trying to make really cool boilerplates for all the MV star frameworks. Originally, this started because I got pretty into Backbone, and I got pretty into Require.js. And if anyone else did the same thing a year ago, there wasn't much documentation on how to use those things and many more libraries, even jQuery and jQuery UI with it together. So I made Backbone Require Boilerplate. A lot of people liked it. A few of my contributors now, we're a team of four right now, hopefully more after this conference. But besides that, I've made a few jQuery plugins. I've made a jQuery plugin called SelectBoxit. If anyone went to TJ's talk yesterday and he was discussing HTML SelectBoxes, they are probably the worst thing HTML has to offer. So what you'll find is a lot of different plugins, you know, creating divs, creating HTML content to mimic what a select box will do. So I've worked heavily on that, so you should check that out. There's a few other jQuery plugins. When I first started writing jQuery plugins, I thought I did it pretty well. I didn't use the Widget Factory. I went on the jQuery IRC, and I talked to Scott Gonzalez a little bit, and Ben Almond, and Ben Almond's like, what are you doing? You probably should just use the Widget Factory. It's way easier. So that was actually my emphasis into learning the Widget Factory. And we'll talk more about that. So now I can officially say that I'm also an author. I made a short Require.js book, so if you're new to AMD, you can check it out. It's called Instant Dependency Management with Require.js. It's only 42 pages. It's like $6, or I'm sure you could find potentially a pirated copy of it online. It's pretty recent, so I don't know if it is pirated, but we'll see. And I'm now, I guess, officially a speaker. I've been doing some local meetups. I'm from Washington, D.C. I've met a few people from Washington, D.C. as well. And I've gone around the scene, talked about jQuery. There's a jQuery D.C. meetup that's pretty popular. So I go around and talk about fun JavaScript things. So the first question is, like, what does modular mean? And pretty much a lot of people have different ideas of what it does mean. For me, it's small pieces. I think everyone can understand the huge JavaScript application that is one page. That's really been the focus of not only this conference, but a lot of other conferences, is structure to your code and making it maintainable in the sense, if you bring someone else onto your project that has not written or seen anything that you've written, are they going to understand how everything logically fits together? So smaller pieces make it easier for me. I love simple things. I don't know about anyone else. I can't stand things that are very complex. So I like to make things small and with a limited scope. The idea, there are always exceptions, but the idea is to do one thing and to do it well. So if you have something that is pointing in all directions, doing a bunch of different things, you probably want to look at that and from an architectural perspective, be like, how should I split this up? So that's a primary focus. And like I said, we want things to be maintainable. It's easier for us. I think all of us want our jobs to be easier. I haven't met one person who's like, I would love for my job to be difficult. I can't wait for it to be difficult. So I mentioned this before, but the inspiration for this talk was Require.js. Although that's not the only inspiration. If people have been doing Node.js, say you're a JavaScript developer, you hadn't been doing a lot of backend, and you start doing Node, you find that Node is using CommonJS for their module format. So in a general sense, it's not just AMD and Require.js that inspired me, it's modules in general and code structure. The reason I pointed Require.js in particular is because it really, for me, was easy to see how everything worked in the browser. If anyone went to Alex Sexton's talk, he talked about Require.js yesterday, and it's really good to educate people that this exists. A lot of people are using this now in their browsers to kind of separate their application into what I like to say is modular. So just in case everyone is still a little bit confused with what Require.js is, here's an example module. And so Require.js uses sort of a global define method. I'm essentially defining a module. I'm not giving it a name in this example. You can set up a name in a different file. But all I'm doing is I have a callback function. I'm returning an object literal. And from a jQuery plugin perspective, this would be all of my default options, perhaps. Like all my default options in their own file. That's all it's doing. It is not doing any smart logic. It's just returning me my default options. So how does this apply to jQuery plugins? We can definitely structure our plugins better. It's very rare if you don't see a jQuery plugin having a huge one file. An example, the very like obvious example is you attach a name to the jQuery prototype. You make sure that the correct this context is returned using return this.each. And then somewhere outside of that, you have a general function constructor. You have a prototype, which handles all of your methods. And then internally, within the return this.each, you are instantiating your quote-unquote object. You're instantiating your function constructor to make it an instance. And then once you have that instance, you can store it in the jQuery data method, and then people can access all the API methods that you've provided. And so this is really fine for really pretty small plugins. And that's why I'm saying, is this bad? It's okay for small plugins, but for anything large or medium to large, it becomes not maintainable really, really quickly. So how can we make it maintainable? The first thing is, for every jQuery plugin, it's pretty much that common boilerplate. So this is really the year of removing boilerplate. Just like 2002 was the year of the JavaScript MVStar framework, this is the year for just trying to remove all boilerplate as much as possible. So if we abstract the boilerplate, and then we assemble our plugin into different independent modules or pieces, that's a way that we can make it maintainable. All right, so we are going to start refactoring what we just saw into different independent pieces. And luckily for us, we don't have to do this from scratch. It seems like with JavaScript, we have so many tools, so we might as well use them. And that leads me to the first tool, which is the jQuery UI Widget Factory. And if no one is familiar with the Widget Factory, basically all the jQuery UI widgets are based on it. It's your standard factory method. I'm assuming the jQuery UI team realized that all the plugins are going to be doing similar things. They want to abstract all that boilerplate, and they want to have just a factory method that outputs plugins. They don't always have to redo that logic. Makes a lot of sense. It's been an inspiration for me and for, I'm sure, other developers. So some of the benefits of the Widget Factory, it provides a consistent foundation and API, like I said, with a factory sort of design pattern. That's typically what you're striving for. It removes that boilerplate. So say, for example, you want to return a pseudo selector in your plugin that gives you all the DOM elements that are calling your plugin. jQuery, if you're using the Widget Factory, it does it for you. You don't have to worry about context. You don't have to worry about setting up your function constructor. As long as you follow the API, it says, hey, put all your stuff in underscore create. This is where your function this is where your plugin begins. This is where you can set instance properties. And you don't really have to worry. It kind of just abstracts that away, which is an amazing thing, especially after you make more than one jQuery plugin. You just get tired of it. And this is really cool. The idea that typically a jQuery UI widget, you give it a namespace and you give it a base name, and they're doing that. They enforce that so that you don't, you know, have any collisions with other plugins. But they also let you pass an object literal as your plugin. And that is inspiring. That is inspiring my talk is the fact that an object literal, that's what you're using to just create your plugin. And it's good to mention that the widget factory can be used entirely separate from jQuery UI. I'll talk to Scott Gonzalez after, but I almost wish the widget factory was separate from jQuery UI, just so people and developers understand that you don't have to use all of like the jQuery UI widget code and any of that. It can be used completely separate. You can use it in a standalone jQuery plugin. So that's important to throw out. So here's a very, very trivial and basic example of a widget factory plugin. Essentially what the widget factory is doing is they're giving you this widget method directly on the jQuery object. And the first argument that we're passing is we're passing a namespace, which is and an example, which is example. The example is just the base name. And then what we do, our second argument is just an object literal. And on our object literal, we can set our default options by setting the options property. If we have an underscore create method, the widget factory, we will make sure to call that, and it's only called once, and that'll be our constructor. There's also an init method in case you recall the constructor with no arguments, but I'm not showing it here for just ease of trying to have all the code on one page. And this is just like an example of a custom method. Like this object, just you can put your own custom methods on it. You can overwrite existing methods that the widget factory gives you and then still reuse what the widget factory gives you kind of in a simple prototypal inheritance way. So that's a simple jQuery UI widget. And don't be confused. This is just the jQuery plugin that it's creating. It's just the same thing that you've always done as a user. So that's an example of calling the plugin. So let's see. The state of our plugin so far, we have removed the jQuery plugin boilerplate because we've added the widget factory, right? We don't have to do return this.each. We don't have to instantiate our plugin constructor. Everything is taken care of for us. So what we still need to do is we need to separate our plugin into independent pieces. Although the widget factory is great, it really doesn't guide you in how can you structure your plugin in potentially different files. So let's figure out how to do that. And then we still need to go through and see how can we create a command line build process to bring all these separate files together. And finally, this is sort of an added bonus for your users, is you want to provide some sort of custom web UI build so that they don't always have to potentially install Grunt, because you know the command line can be a scary place, and Ben Allman is making it less scary with Grunt, but people are still worried. People still don't know how to use Grunt. So let's make it easy, and let's try to make a web UI build. All right. So I like simplicity. Our first file, this would potentially be options.js, and this is similar to the required JS example I first showed. I'm going to assume that this is going to be the first file in our build. If you are worried about different ways of ordering, or if you're worried about which plugins get called when, or you don't care about order, you would obviously do the simple example of var example equals example or object literal, but we will assume this will be the first file. So my local object literal right now is I'm storing an options property, and obviously this could be much longer than just some option true, but a trivial example, but you can probably see how it could get bigger. Let's pretend we have this underscore create .js file, and that's going to hold all of our constructor. It'll just be the constructor, right? So a constructor method can get pretty big with the jQuery plugin. There's a lot of instance properties you're probably setting when you first run the plugin. So this could get fairly large. So let's just say, let's just put that all in one file. So you're probably seeing that right now I'm separating each little bit of functionality into a separate file. The reality is it's overkill, usually, to do that. So you kind of have to make your own little modular decisions about maybe you have a couple methods stored in this file, or maybe certain things, you're going to have interdependencies. You have to make those decisions about which files should be separated and what should be inside, what the content should be inside of those. And then once we, you know, say we've gone through, we've decoupled our plugin, and then now that we have our local example object, we can very easily call the widget factory, you know, just using the standard $.widget, and then pass the namespace and base name, and pass our object literal, and boom, you have your jQuery plugin. So again, let's review what we've done. Again, we remove the jQuery plugin boilerplate, use the widget factory, awesome. We've separated our plugin into independent pieces. That is really rad. We still need to do a few things. We've seen before, create a command line build process and create a web build process. So before we talk about the command line build process, a very common question I think a lot of developers have is, are there any alternatives to the widget factory? I've looked, there aren't many. So, I mean, a lot of times you can just use the widget factory, it's not a problem. If you want to add a few features, if you want something a little bit different, I guess I'm officially releasing what's called jQ Factory, and it's heavily inspired by the widget factory. There are a few extra features, some things are structurally and foundationally different than the widget factory. So if you're interested in checking it out, like I said, it's inspired by the widget factory. An additional feature I'm doing is it's supporting jQuery prototype namespacing. So I always like to use Twitter Bootstrap as an example. Twitter Bootstrap has how many plugins now? Like 10 to 12 jQuery plugins. And say that you want to call the tooltip method. You're going to call your jQuery object.tooltip. There is no namespace. When it would make a whole lot of sense if you said jQuery object.bootstrap --tooltip. So if you want to namespace your jQuery plugins, the widget factory does a great job underneath the hood of namespacing. But if you actually want to namespace on the jQuery prototype, it's a little feature that gets added in. There's other structural differences between the jQ factory and the widget factory. Like I show here, I have an elegant way if your jQuery plugin depends on some asynchronous activity when you initialize, there's an easy built-in deferred object sort of way of handling that. And there's all sorts of other stuff. There's automatic event binding. So the idea is if you group most of your event handlers associated with your plugin in an object, when you destroy your plugin, if you put everything in one place and jQ Factory knows about it, it makes it really easy to loop through and remove everything. So if you're doing event delegation, it handles that. If you're, say you're binding a click handler to the window, which I'm not saying you should, but if you did that, and you put it inside of the events object, this jQ factory will know, let's unbind that, and let's, obviously it's been bound with an event namespace, similar to how the widget factory does it. So I'm gonna go through a really brief example. It's very, very similar to the widget factory. You'll see that instead of a .widget, I have a .jQ factory. And again, I'm enforcing a namespace because enforcing a namespace is the best practice. You don't want collisions. And for this example, it's not enforcing the prototype namespace. I'll show you how to do that later if you're interested. But again, passing an object literal, and obviously this is not a modular plugin, but in one sense, it's easier to show everything here for presentation's sake. But you have the options property, the ideas, the jQ factory will first call _create, and that's where I'm thinking you'll set your instance properties, and then it'll call _render, when that's where you'll be setting your DOM elements, and then after everything is rendered, it will bind all of the events that are stored inside of your events object, and then after that, it will call the _postEvents method, and at that point, you'll know that all the events have been bound, all the DOM elements have been rendered. It's more opinionated, I think, than what the widget factory is doing, and you don't really have to have these methods. You couldn't have them at all, and by default. It just won't do anything. It won't do anything wrong. But that's how I would envision a jQuery plugin to usually work. So this is definitely not an underscore and Lodash moment. I just want to make that clear. Like the widget factory is amazing. For most cases, it's a great utility for your jQuery plugins. Just some fundamental differences. An important note is that the widget factory is battle tested. There are obviously, because of all the jQuery UI widgets are using it, I'm not sure how many regular jQuery plugins are, but I know I was, and I'm sure a lot more developers were using it. So in terms of bugs, it's battle tested. JQ Factory is new. I wrote it in the last 2 weeks, like any good software, right? Within 2 weeks. But besides that, we won't be reviewing it much more in detail. If you're interested, check it out. It's on GitHub now. It does not have a fancy homepage, but it does have a nice README with some documentations and sort of a developer guide to kind of go through the paces of how you'd start to make your plugin with jQ Factory. But yeah, that's enough of that. We'll continue onward with our custom build process. All right, so the plugin build process. We've separated all of our plugin files, our plugin like properties into separate files, and now we want to bring it all together. And ultimately, we want a custom build. It makes it easy for external users, say they don't want a certain aspect of your API, they don't need it, as long as it's separated out. So for that, we're going to use Grunt. Grunt is a Node.js task runner, and it does that. It does one thing, and it does it well, like a lot of other really good software solutions. And it is perfect for automating anything that is repetitive. It's basically a JavaScript developer's dream for automation. I'm sure almost everyone has used it now because so many different other projects have maybe created Grunt plugins, or you see things with automatic unit testing. Obviously with custom builds, with minification, with JS hinting or JS linting your code automatically, watch tasks so that you don't actually have to run them. There's a lot of things that go into using Grunt that it gives you. And like I said, it's a huge plugin ecosystem. It's an easy API on top of Node. You don't have to use plugins. You could just use the API for doing things with the file system. A lot of really cool things. So unfortunately, this file has slightly a lot of code. I was trying not to make it too much code. But if you haven't seen a Grunt file before, basically what you do is you wrap your entire Grunt file in a module.exports, and then you set it to a function. And internally, Grunt will pass a local Grunt object to you. And what you're doing is you're going to set all your initial configurations, your Grunt configurations, using the initconfig method. And inside of the initconfig, you see I have two high-level properties. I have a concat property, and I have a wrap property. And the concat is actually going to help us because whatever plugins the user enters, whatever files the user wants, that's actually going to be passed to the concat property. And the concat plugin, this is just the configuration for it, the concat plugin and other Grunt plugins are officially maintained by the Grunt team. The wrap plugin is a user plugin. So that actually is not officially maintained by the Grunt team, but you'll see a lot of that. There's like, I'm not sure, Ben Allman, you can probably speak of this. I'm not sure how many official Grunt plugins there are, probably more than eight that they've abstracted away in the 0.04 release. So essentially, the concat brings everything together, and the wrap makes it so that you don't, typically when you're making a plugin, you're making a library, you're gonna make sure that an immediately invoked function expression is wrapping your library, right? To make sure that it's locally scoped. If you're using jQuery, to make sure that the dollar sign is scoped correctly, like you don't want to worry if prototype is on the page or anything like that. So we're just going to use the wrap plugin just to make sure that after we concatenate our entire file, or all of our files, it's wrapped in an immediately invoked function expression. And besides that, typically with Grunt, when you are loading plugins, you have to use the load npm task method on the Grunt object and just pass it the name of the plugin. So that's the first part of our Grunt file. The next part is gonna be the actual custom tasks. It's a very simple custom task that we'll write. And when I say very simple, meaning that I wrote it, so you guys should just automatically understand it, I think it's simple. So what we're doing is we're actually registering a task, and we're gonna call this task a custom build. Custom build is the task name. give it a little description, not much description, and then pass it just a function. So we're just gonna loop through. Essentially what I'm doing here, I have some default files. This can obviously be abstracted. You could have different files. For now, I'm assuming we have this options.js, underscore create.js, underscore plugin.js, and a custom method.js. And it's going through, and it's seeing which files the user wants to exclude, and it's kind of just removing them from the array. So essentially, it's going through my local array, it's seeing which files, which arguments the user entered, and it's removing them. And when you remove them, basically what I'm doing is I'm if you see lower, right around here, I'm doing grunt.config.set, so I'm setting a configuration property, and I'm passing it my custom files array. And the custom files array will be the up-to-date array after I've removed anything that needs to be removed. And then after I set my configuration property, I run two different grunt tasks. Like we had seen before, I had set up the concat task and the wrap task. And those will be back-to-back, so concat will happen, and then everything will get wrapped. So the way that you run your custom build, you can follow the grunt directions for that. You have to have Node.js installed. Obviously, if you have Node.js installed, you'll get npm. And then you'll install the grunt CLI npm module. And that gives you the option now to use grunt as a global property in your command line. So all we have to do now is if we say grunt custom build, that will run our custom build task. By default, I'm not passing any arguments here, which means that all of my files will get built. So this would be like, I want everything. Just give me everything. I don't care about modular stuff. And like I said, this will just include everything. If you wanted to exclude a file, it's very easy to do with colon separated arguments. I'm showing only one example here. This would be, I want to make a custom build, and I want to exclude your custom method.js. I don't want that. I don't need it for my application. You can continue doing colon-separated arguments. It would make it really easy if you've separated your jQuery plugin into different files. Makes it pretty easy for a user, as long as they've got grunt, which a lot of people already have, to be like, I don't want this, I don't want this, I don't want that. Just give me what I need. So hopefully you'll have a success. I had a success. And don't worry about this undefined thing. I'll just have to talk to the maintainer of the wrap plugin. But essentially, we created our jQuery plugin without custom method.js, without any errors, and I saved it inside of source.js into the jQuery.custombuild.js file. So after, you might be interested what the source code would be. Unfortunately, I haven't worried about indentation. For now, there are options for you to do that, but I won't talk about it. You'll see that I only have options.js, create.js, or underscore create.js, and underscore plugin.js. I no longer have my underscore custom method.js. Makes it really easy to do custom builds. So again, let's review what we've done. We have removed the boilerplate, right? We still used our widget factory. We've separated our plugin into independent files. We've created a command line build process using grunt. And we don't need to do this, but the best practice, again, is to create a web build so that people who don't want to use grunt can still have a similar experience. All right, so for web custom builds, I wrote this like a year ago, maybe more, this download builder.js. So we'll delve into that a little bit. Again, I can't make icons. I use the generic HTML5 icon because I'm using the HTML5 file system. So designers, please help me. I am terrible at icons. Something cool about this is basically what it can do is you can either fetch local files or you can fetch your files from GitHub. GitHub stores all of your file content in encoding, base64 encoding. And then it makes it very easy as long as you can, if you're in a newer-ish browser like IE10 up, or if you're in Firefox, Chrome, you have base encoding, base64 encoding by default. But if you want lower level IE support, you're gonna have to install a polyfill. But it fetches it using the base64 encoding. And after it fetches all your different files, it will concatenate them, which is really easy, right? Just string concatenation. and then it'll save a reference to that file that you just saved. In the HTML5 file system API is a blob. So a blob is like a temporary URL in your file system that you can just, it points to it and you can just grab it. And then if you're worried about caching, say that your library is the next big thing, right? If you're worried about caching, it'll support caching all those files instead of making those requests, those JSONP requests. It'll cache it via session storage, so you don't have to worry as much. Again, it also allows you to put in your OAuth client IDs and passwords. I know GitHub, it only gives you about 50 requests if you don't actually sign your requests. So it lets you pass that as well if you want more, like 5,000 per hour, I think. All right, so if you want to use downloadbuilder.js, essentially what we're first going to do is we're going to be creating our HTML, and our HTML is only going to be checkboxes. So inside of each checkbox, inside of each value of each checkbox, we're going to put the relative file path of your GitHub repository as the value. So I'm putting, say for example, you had all of your JavaScript files in your GitHub repo in a source slash JS. Slash like, that's it, just inside of the source file or folder. So right now I'm doing it kind of a hacky way. Things that we don't want to allow a user to change, I'm kind of just making them hidden on the page. And then my library can still pull, hey, let's grab this because it's checked. By default, it's checked. You'll see the first three are hidden, yet checked because I'm making them required. The last one is visible because I'm saying the custom method.js is going to be, you can take it or leave it. I don't care. Let's make that visible, and you can check it off or not. Now that we have our HTML, we do have to create a builder instance. So this is kind of our global properties. And like I said, I wrote this over a year ago, and I'm sorry that you have to use the new keyword. I know lots of people get upset about using the new keyword, but it's okay. You guys can calm down. So for this, just say I want my location to, it could either be GitHub or it could be local, but we'll just go with GitHub for now. It'll be GitHub, put your GitHub author name, just the username. So mine's jfranko, and then the repo is made up. I just made it up for jQuery.exampleplugin.js. You can specify which branch you want to pull from. And again, here is the OAuth client ID and client secret in case you want to have more requests per GitHub. So now that you have this builder instance, you can actually build your file. I have, say there's a fake generate button. Essentially, anytime someone clicked generate custom build, the idea would be to grab all the checkboxes that were in fact checked. And it's like, okay, all of those files that are checked, I know that's what a user wants. So the idea is to pass all the checkboxes that are checked as the first argument, and then you pass the name of the file that you would like it to be, because again, I'm saving this file that you're getting in the HTML5 file system. So whatever name you want it to be and whatever language you want it to be, which again gets set using the HTML5 file system. So after that, you just pass it a callback function, and within that callback function, you get a local data parameter, and inside of that you get the content of your concatenated file. You get the dynamic URL, and that URL will actually point to wherever it's stored on your local file system. And there's a way in Chrome where you can just have it download instead of point to a new page. You can have it easily download the local file system file. So besides that, it just gives you the name and the language in case you're interested in what that is. But it makes it really easy to do custom builds. And if you look at a lot of popular different libraries around the web that are JavaScript, most of them are using a backend. You totally can do this with a backend script. This is really for someone, say you're just a front-end JavaScript developer, you don't want to worry about, I don't want to make a PHP script, I don't want to make a Java backend, I don't want to even make a Node backend. I want something that works, that will grab my files from GitHub and will give a user a custom build in a really simple-ish way. And the example I always give is I'm doing this for SelectBoxit. I guess I can show that. Gotta love live demos. It's really high zoom. But the idea is kind of like this, right? You have all these different checkboxes. Oh, I don't want the copy attributes thing. And it takes a second. I could probably use a loading state. But for the most part, what it does, it'll eventually grab my content from GitHub. And then if you want to download the unminified JavaScript, this is not using the Chrome specific, I don't remember what the custom attribute is, for actually downloading content that you know is going to be downloadable. But if you look higher up, which you can't actually see, hold on. Well, it's okay. In the file system, you'll notice it's like the actual URL is blob colon something, which means it's stored as a blob. It's actually on your local machine. So it's kind of cool. And let's see if I can go back to here. All right. So I guess the real closing thoughts here is, like we've all seen, I mean, this is not just the jQuery conference, this is a JavaScript conference, and JavaScript is being taken seriously. So I guess what I'm trying to get across is that jQuery plugins can be taken just as seriously as any other piece of code. So hopefully, you know, you learned something new. Maybe it even gave you a thought that you can improve upon what I've kind of set out. But thank you for listening. Again, my GitHub is gfranko. My Twitter handle is gregfranko. So tweet me, talk to me at the conference, send a pull request to make JQ Factory better. But yeah, I appreciate you guys for coming out. Thank you. I guess if there are any questions, you can either, I guess we can do questions now. I don't know if we have enough time. I might have run over. No, I guess I'm right on time. All right, 2 minutes of questions, if anyone has it.
2 whole minutes of quietly moving and answering questions.
Who had a question?
Someone have a question? Or no?
No? No?
Okay.
That was fun, man.
Yeah. Greg? When you break your modules out into separate files for the create and all that, how do you organize your file structure? Do you end up having a subdirectory for each widget?
All right. Well, usually I haven't set it out into different folders. I'm usually keeping all of my quote unquote modules in the same, you know, file or same folder. You can totally split it out if you wanted to. You would just need to handle that in your custom build process. So it's up to you. It doesn't really matter for me. Like I said, I've been putting everything in the same folder. It's pretty much up to the developer. So, cool.